we just sort of ended up with this theorem. And well, this theorem stated, you remember that the Fourier transform of the response function of your instrument is equal to the autocorrelation of the distribution of the complex amplitude in the pupil plane. And then I asked you, well, in case we would have an interferometer made of two square apertures, and you flip one interferometer in front of the other one, well, the result that you should obtain is something like that. This should be the shape of the autocorrelation. Yeah. Did some of you try to get that result or not? You? Yes. Manu? You too, Joseph?
We have a problem with the central peak.
Well, I think there is no problem with the central peak for the following reason. I will show you. Yeah. So let's assume, So we just put some light. So let's assume that this is our interferometer. So these are the two apertures, So what we do first, well, we take an image of this one and we put it on a rail, just here. So I just make an offset. This is the one, and this one will come here, more or less, And then we know, so, well, the displacement, is exactly, so this distance is A, But now, well, I said the size of this one is big A, and the separation between the two big ones is B, correct? Yeah. So, well, I should not use here A, but I should use something else, maybe K. So what you are trying to do is just to make a correlation, autocorrelation, of function. It's a function where fx, is what is represented here, So we agree that now I will represent here the result, So when I offset by exactly, well, in fact, the offset is, So this, in this case, k is equal to minus b plus a over half. You agree? So b is this distance, and something like that. So this is the offset which is represented now. So we know that for that value, so we are here, so it's a minus b minus a. It's just starting, Okay? So as we are shifting. Now, when we are perfectly aligned, we reach the maximum. And after, so it would just show the scenario, when this one is here and the other one is here, we are just at the minimum. Correct, No. It's one. Okay. After, we will have the following scenario. This one is here, and this one is here. Correct? And we see, as we shall just move, this one will pass over this one, but this one will pass over the other one too. And here the shift is about minus a plus a. So therefore we get a double peak. You agree? So this is the origin of the double peak. And then as we are shifting after this, okay, here, then we are already at the end of the third peak, which is not as high, something like that. So you agree? Yeah, when you make the experiment, yeah, in the lab, yeah, of course you will get what is represented here. You will get this function, yeah, on your image in two dimension, yeah. So I would like you to take the Fourier transform of that, yeah, and see if you find something similar to what is shown here. But it will be slightly different because in the case of this interferometer, yeah, which is circulating, the aperture, it went all through, yeah? Yeah, yeah. Well, the aperture are not square, but they are circular, yeah? So in fact, in two dimension, what you will see, what one should see is something like that, yeah? When you make the Fourier transform of the direct image. Yeah? Okay. So now it will be a bit. I shall continue, yeah, where I was last time. Yeah. So you remember last time I mentioned that you may have different types of focus for a telescope. Yeah. So one was a Newton, yeah, focus, yeah, thanks to a flat mirror placed here, yeah. And in fact, it was Newton who designed, yeah, first, yeah, this kind of focus. Then you also have the prime focus, yeah. So the idea is to put a detector here, yeah, or even the observer, yeah, can go there. But in order to place an observer, yeah, at this focus, yeah, you need a very big diameter for the mirror, yeah. And this is what is shown here. You see, well, here inside, yeah, the inner tube, yeah, an astronomer observing at the prime focus. This is a 5 meter Palomar telescope, yeah. And you see him here during observations. And this is the kind of focus which disappeared today, but we were lucky enough when we were in Chile in 1976, yeah, to make many, many, many tests with a 3.6 meter telescope of ESO. So what happens is that before you enter the cage, yeah, the telescope, yeah, go to the horizontal position, then you enter in the tube, yeah, you're on your back, yeah, and then, well, the telescope is being sent, yeah, to a star, to a target, yeah. Now the difficulty, yeah, is that when you reach the zenith, if you don't change the position of the seat, yeah, you may, yeah, find yourself with your back, yeah, up, and well, it's very uneasy, yeah, to observe in that position. Well, then you have the so-called Cassegrain focus, yeah. So you have a concave mirror here, yeah, and just reflecting the light outside, yeah, as a hole in the prime mirror. Well, there you may attach, yeah, already a big spectrograph or a big camera, and make observations. And there the field of view is really fixed. It's not rotating, yeah? So you may just leave your instrument fixed. Then you have the so-called Coudé focus, yeah? Which is a very interesting one, yeah? So the light rays, yeah, come here. They're reflected on the primary mirror. They go on a concave secondary one. They come back here on a flat mirror set at 45 degrees. Which is just at the intersection, you see, of the declination axis and of the optical axis. Then the beam goes on another flat mirror here, which is just along the north-south axis, yeah, which is the polar axis around which the telescope, yeah, is spinning. And then it is being reflected, yeah, well, on a lower floor, yeah. And there you may set a very big instrument, yeah? So, well, at La Silla in Chile, yeah, they had a huge spectrograph, yeah, which weight was a few tons, yeah, of a material. And you may observe there, yeah, very peacefully, especially in winter, it's very pleasant because you are in a warm room, yeah, rather than here, it's very cold outside. Well, the only problem is that while the telescope is following your star, the field of view here is rotating, yeah? So if you observe a point-like star, it's not the problem because a point is a point, yeah? Even if it is spinning around the axis, yeah? But if you would observe, well, a planetary nebula, What you would need is a so-called derotator. So it is a device which just derotates the field of view. Yeah, but it's very classical. Now this is another type of telescope, the so-called Schmidt telescope. Yeah, which is a marvelous type of instrument. It consists of a flat mirror here. And you remember I told you during a previous lecture that the external rays would converge faster than the inner rays. Yeah? So it is affected by the so-called spherical aberration. Yeah? And you should correct for that. And there is a technician of the Hamburg Observatory, just before the war, Second World War, who invented something. He just said, if the external rays converge too fast, we may just set a lens here at the center of curvature of the spherical mirror, which is slightly concave on one side and flat on the other one. This one were not converging fast enough, so it just gave to this lens a sort of convex shape, and here still concave, And when you set that, at the center of curvature of the spherical mirror, you correct for the spherical aberrations. Yeah. Now, it means that all the rays get focused into a single point. Yeah. But the surface in the focal plane is slightly spherical. Yeah. So if you set a photographic plate, you have to push with a special system to give the right curvature. Yeah. Well, with a photographic film, it was very easy. If you would put CCDs, you would set the CCDs on a curved shape. But as you may see, the focal length is very short, compared to the size of the mirror. Yeah? So you may produce a very fast camera for extended object. So this is excellent. So the F ratio, I told you before, is a focal to diameter. It's very small. And it's excellent for the discovery of comets, for imaging galaxies, very faint surface brightness objects, extended objects. Yeah. And the field of view here is huge. Yeah. The typical field of view of such an instrument is about 5 by 5 degrees. So it's 25 square degrees. Yeah. So in 5 degrees, you may set 10 times the size of the moon. 10 times by 10 times is about 100 moons or 100 suns. Yeah? So it's a huge field of view, very good for discoveries. And today, with developed technology, high-tech companies can even make a very wide field. I remember at Amos, they made a Schmidt telescope for a space mission, which field of view was 25 by 25 degrees. Yeah. So it's huge, you could set there 10,000 moons, or 10,000 suns on just one plate, So very nice. So this is a very nice kind of instrument, very good for surveys because you cover a very large area, of the sky, in just one exposure. Okay. Well, I already talked to you about. The big telescopes, which exist today, like the VLTs, in Paranal in Chile, by ESO, or the two 10-meter telescopes, the Keck telescopes, in Mauna Kea in Hawaii. Well, then you also have the Space Telescope, which is certainly a marvelous instrument because it is above the atmosphere, especially if you observe in the ultraviolet, that you cannot do from the ground, you can make a unique science. And this graph shows you, it was made already maybe 10 years ago, the increasing size of the telescope is a function of time, and this is a logarithmic scale, and VLT, Keck were here, and then, this is a good location for ELTs or TMTs, which are just coming around. Okay, now just a little bit about X-ray telescopes, a few words. Well, you know, X-rays are very penetrating, yeah, radiation. And if you just take a mirror and just let the X-rays going onto it, yeah, they will just go through the mirror because they are so hard, yeah. So the only chance to reflect X-rays, yeah, is to make reflection by grazing incidence, yeah. So very, very high angle of incidence, very near to 90 degrees, yeah. And so well, people have thought about producing, you see here is a parabolic mirror, but you only use the external envelope, yeah, of this paraboloid, because you see that if you use, yeah, the external ring of the parabola, well, the reflection is almost grazing, yeah? So it's a very high incidence angle. Well, here it would not work, yeah? So the X-ray would go through, but here it can be reflected, yeah? But here, well, the focal length usually is still a bit long, and then since you need to take such a telescope in space, because you may not observe X-rays, yeah, from the ground because of the atmosphere, to shorten the focal length, well, people have thought about, well, using a second conical mirror, which is called an hyperboloid, yeah, an hyperboloid. And in this way, it's possible, you see here the grazing incidence angle, which is large, here still, but you're shortening the focal length, yeah? So instead of going there, you just get here. But then you say, well, it's a pity, so what about the rest? Well, the rest you don't take, yeah, you just exclude it. And you may say, well, but the collecting area of the X-ray telescope is very small, yeah? So what people have thought about doing is just to put inside each other many such external rings, yeah, of paraboloids and of hyperboloids. Yeah? So what you see here is a view, if you look here through this direction, yeah, you see here it's a paraboloid, followed by an hyperbolic, followed by a parabolic, followed by an hyperbolic, yeah, envelope. And when, well, XM and Newton, which is still an X-ray telescope, yeah, which is observing the sky right now, yeah, by the space European Space Agency, yeah, you have 58 envelopes, yeah, which are set into each other, yeah, 58 envelopes. So it gives you a very nice collecting area at the end, yeah. Now, a very long, long time ago, well, such a telescope did not exist, and they were just cellular collimators, yeah. So they were sheets of a certain substance, yeah, sent in the outer space, so in space, and depending on the orientation, yeah, of these cellular collimators and on the number of hits by X-rays, they could say, oh, the source was located in that direction, yeah, or in that, into that direction, yeah, but no information on the flux, yeah. A very rough idea of the location of the source, yeah. And well, the first people who detected X-rays in the sky were American army, yeah, American soldiers, yeah, because they were interested in knowing whether the Russians were not sending nuclear weapons, yeah, somewhere. And so, well, from time to time, they were identifying, yeah, sources of X-ray emission. And very often from the same direction. So they contacted astronomers and asked them, well, do you think this could be due to a celestial body? Yeah? And indeed, nice music. And indeed, yeah, the reason why they were detecting X-rays, yeah, was due not to nuclear weapons, but due to stars, quasars, galaxies, which were emitting large amounts of X-rays. Yeah? So was the first such a telescope, yeah, was an Einstein satellite, and the PI was Riccardo Giacconi, who got well, later on a Nobel Prize, yeah, for the kind of science that he achieved using that telescope. But the idea did not come from him, yeah, but he was rich enough to implement it as a space X-ray telescope. Now, these are just images, yeah, of two satellites which are observing the sky right now, Chandra and XM and Newton, Alors, Excelsior Newtonien is a European space vehicle consisting of three telescopes, each having 58 envelopes of paraboloid and hyperboloid. And this is Chandra, which is not such a big collecting area, but has a better angular resolution. Now, this is a view on one of the telescopes of XMN Newton. You see here the 58 external envelopes of paraboloids and hyperboloids, which are assembled all together. And you see it's a huge telescope. And it was tested at the Liège Space Center before it was launched. So they just constructed a special tower with an emitter of X-ray to test the telescopes.
There is a gap between those...
Slight gap. Yep, absolutely. Yep. Well, it's...
looks like it is compactly.
Yeah, but the rays can go through it. Yep. Now, you agree, if I just consider one paraboloid, just one, I may represent, in the pupil plane, its cross-section is shown here, Now, if you'd like to know, well, what is the response function, of that instrument in the focal plane, Because, well, this is a converging, it's a paraboloid, Well, what you do, you just take the square, of the Fourier transform, of that pupil function, And what you see is represented here, So you see there are many peaks with a width, which is a size determined by the radius of this paraboloid. So it's 1 over r. But you see there is an envelope here, an envelope, which is modulating the signal. And the width of that envelope is 1 over delta r, where delta r is the thickness of the paraboloid. And unfortunately, all these peaks are mixing between each other. And the final angular accuracy of an X-ray telescope, even so that the wavelength is very short, extremely short, is just for XMN Newton about 5 seconds of arc. So this is the angular resolution of XMN Newton, which is given by more or less this width. So it's not so good, but still, for Chandra, it's about 1 second of arc. So it's already much better, but smaller collecting area. Now, a few words about radio telescopes. So, to reflect the radio waves, what you need is a collecting area, which is, about accurate at a fraction of the wavelengths you are observing. So if you are observing in the meter range of wavelengths, if the accuracy of the paraboloid is of the order of 1 centimeter, it's okay, it's good, So you see, it's much easier to make a paraboloid with an accuracy of 1 centimeter than making a mirror with a small fraction of the wavelengths of the light, of the visible light, And here, what is shown is, just a small diagram and then pictures of the Heffelsberg radio telescope. Well, it is located, about 150 kilometers from here, so in the Heffel area. And it has a size of 100 meters. Now the mount is of the altazimuthal type, so vertical axis and horizontal axis. And of course, you may equip the radio telescopes either with an antenna or with a waveguide. Now sometimes you may get here, instead of having the detector here, you may set a small reflector, a concave, and focusing with the radio waves at the surface of the primary mirror. And this is known as a Gregory focus. It was invented in the 18th century by an optical astronomer, but I think it was never used at optical wavelengths, but in the radio it has been used. Okay. Now, here I have a nice story to tell you. This is a, well, 300 feet radio telescope in Green Bank, yeah, before 1988, yeah. And it could be moved only around the east-west axis, yeah. So just like that, yeah. North-south, yeah. And so whenever a radio source would pass, yeah, in the meridian, yeah, you could, with an antenna, detect its signal. It fell down. It was completely destroyed, yeah. And the reason was that it had been built, yeah, to last for about 10, 15 years, yeah. This was a lifetime, yeah. But then they extended, yeah. And after 30 years, about, yeah, whoops, it crashed, yeah. Well, fortunately, very near to this place, yeah, was living a very, very influential senator in the Congress, yeah, of the, in Virginia. It was located in Virginia. And he saw that the astronomers were so desperate that he said, you will get a new telescope. Yeah? And so when the Congress, and he really pushed the things, and they got, yeah, a fantastic new 100-meter steerable telescopes, yeah, Altaz, with extremely high precision. So it's not 1 centimeter precision, but it's lower than 1 millimeter precision. Yeah, so they may even observe at very short wavelengths. Yeah, and it has been very widely used. Yeah, and provided very interesting results. Yeah. Okay, now another type of radio telescope. Yeah, is a Nansei type of telescope. Well, it consists first, yeah, of a flat mirror here. It's oriented, yeah, east-west, so it may catch the radio waves, yeah, north-south. And it reflects, yeah, those radio waves, yeah, on a spherical mirror, which is fixed, yeah, which is fixed. So this is a circular mirror. You see the size 300 meters. And, you know, as the source moves east-west, yeah, of course, in the focal plane, yeah, well, the image travels, yeah. So they have here on a rail, on two rails, yeah, detectors which follow up with an antenna, yeah, the object, and they are just measuring the signal, yeah. And it is mainly performing at 21 centimeter in the hydrogen line, yeah. Okay. Now another impressive radio telescope is Arecibo. It's just a spherical radio telescope, yeah, located in a crater. It's a crater in a volcano, yeah. So it cannot be moved, yeah. But you see, there is an antenna which is attached, yeah, by three cables, and by just pulling different cables, it may move the antenna above the spherical field of view and get very good data. It was the most powerful radio telescope that has detected many, many pulsars, yeah? Extremely many. Now, well, when you are using a radio telescope, yeah, you cannot register the image in the focal plane, yeah, because, well, two-dimensional detectors do not exist, yeah, yeah, more or less. Well, nowadays it's changing, but what you're using is just an antenna, fixed antenna, or a waveguide, yeah? And so, well, here is shown two rays coming from a very distant object in that direction, making an angle theta, yeah? And so what you see here is just a translation, yeah, of the response function of the radio telescope, yeah? So it's a point spread function, yeah, which is very translated, yeah? And so what you do at this time, yeah, the antenna is just measuring the signal which is passing here. But when the source will be located along the optical axis, yeah, well, then it will be measuring this part, yeah, of the point spread function. And so you just let the object drifting, yeah, with respect to the telescope, and you measure the signal in one dimension, yeah. And now, well, if your telescope is steerable, what you can do is just scan the sky, yeah, pixel per pixel, and make an image, yeah. But you just make it or either using an antenna or using a waveguide, yeah. Okay, so, well, I just pass the details, it's not important. What about radio interferometer, yeah? Well, it is shown here. Yeah. So here is a radio interferometer, and as I told you, sometimes it's possible at the radio wavelength to measure the electric field and to transform it into intensity. Yeah, keeping the phase also. Yeah. So let's assume that you're observing an object just located at the zenith. Yeah. Well, you know that the wavefront falls like that on the two mirrors. There is no time delay between the two light rays. Well, so you just set the cursor here, in the middle, and you let the two signals interfere, and you get the fringes. Yeah. Now, when the source is located in that direction, you see that the wavefront is just reaching that telescope after reaching that one. Yeah. So you must correct for time delays. So what you do, well, you just set the cursor here to make this path shorter, and to compensate, and you measure the fringes again. Yeah? So you see, you can do it in a much easier way than at optical wavelengths, where you needed delay lines, very complex ones. Yeah? So here it's just made electronically. And here is a response function of the radio telescope in polar coordinates. So what you see is that, well, along the y direction, I would say the q direction, the aperture of the lobe here is 2 lambda over d, where d is the size of a single radio telescope, because you have no interference. Yeah? But along the perpendicular direction, what you see is that, well, of course you have, a very wide lobe with the same size, but it is modulated by the interference, and it gives you a precision angular resolution which is about 2 lambda over d, where d is the distance between the two radio telescopes. Yeah? Just like for an optical interferometer, it's exactly the same. Okay, this we already showed, well, we just went through it. So now what I propose, I don't know what time is it now?
2:10.
So just a small demonstration, okay? So let's assume, well, it's true for a radio telescope or for an optical telescope, that instead of having two telescopes, you have n telescope, where n can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And they're represented here in case of radio telescopes, Then we just make the right connections, to let the signal interfering. And well, here is what is represented, is the cross-section of the radio telescope in the pupil plane. Just let's assume that you have a squared aperture, So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 radio telescopes. And now we are wondering, well, what should be the response function of such an interferometer, okay? So once more, So this is the y-axis, this is the x-axis, So here I just set one aperture. Here on the opposite side, second one, but same shape, of course, Then here, more or less. And so on, And let's assume that P0 of xy is a function representing this aperture in the pupil plane when it is centered around xy. So I assume that it is being centered. So what is a representation of the pupil xy? Composed, not of four radio telescopes, but of n. So what I may write, well, it's just a summation, from small n equals 0 to n minus 1. So in this case, we have n equal to 4. Now I would say, well, of the P0 here. Now, not centered on x, because, well, here I have assumed that this one is centered just here. but I have to give an offset, yeah? So it will be x minus n minus 1 times a half. Okay, now I assume that the distance between two consecutive radio telescopes, yeah, is small a. Yeah? And then I say minus n a. Okay, let's try to see if this is correct or not, yeah? Well, if n equals 0, yeah? If n equals 0, I should find this one, yeah? N equal 1, n equal 2, n equal 3. Because I go from 0 to 3, yeah? 4 minus 1, yeah? So if n equals 0, I find that it's P0 of x minus n minus 1, yeah, would be 4 minus 1, 3, divided by 2, 1.5. So 1.5a. And then minus 0, yeah, for the first one, yeah? So I will try to see if it's correct. The first one, is it centered on this value?
Yes.
I would say no. Why? Because here I know I should set a plus, and here a minus. Indeed, yeah. When I say it is centered here, yeah, it means that if x plus 1.5a is equal to 0, then it is centered, yeah. So I find that x is equal to minus 1.5. Times a, yeah. So here should be a plus and not a minus. Yeah. Now after, when n equal 1, yeah, of course, yeah, I shift by 1a, then 2a, and then 3a, and then it's correct. So this should be the good representation, yeah, of the offset. So what we know is that the distribution of amplitude, yeah, in the focal plane is a Fourier transform, yeah, is a Fourier transform of PXY. Yeah? So let's take the Fourier transform of this, yeah? So the Fourier transform of a summation, yeah, of terms is a summation of the Fourier transform of each term, yeah? So it will be summation of n equals 0, n minus 1, of P0, so of the Fourier transform of P0 of x plus n minus 1, a half minus n times a. Now, I would like to remind you, yeah, the following property of the Fourier transform, yeah? If I say the Fourier of x minus a, we've seen that, which depends on p, yeah? We've seen that this is equal to a minus I2 pi p a times the Fourier transform of the function x of p. You remember this property, yeah? So here I may write that this is equal to summation from n equals 0 to n minus 1, so of a I 2 pi, yeah, multiplied by n minus 1 times a over 2 minus n a, something like this, and then I should multiply by p. You agree? Times the Fourier transform of p0, so here I forgot y, of xy. Yeah? So I may revise this as follows. you know, the complex exponentiation here may be represented here as a multiplication of several independent complex exponentiation. So I may just write that this is equal to EI 2 pi times N A, like this, divided by EI pi A times P. Okay. Times the summation of n equals 0 to n minus 1 of 2 pi n a p times the Fourier transform of p0 xy of pq. Yeah, just check. Now, if we calculate the following ratio, Rn minus 1 divided by R minus 1, so I just find that it goes this one, then this goes away, minus n, I have R n minus 1, so it's plus R n minus 2, plus, then I have R n minus 2, etc., and I go plus 1. So this is equal to R n minus 1 plus R n minus 2 plus 1. So I may replace this summation here by something more simple. So I just say, okay, HPQ is equal to CP over multiplied by, it will be E minus I pi A P times N minus 1 over E minus I to N A P minus 1 times the Fourier transform of so x, y, pq. Agree? Correct? We continue now. I will distribute this term on each side. So I will get divided by E. Transform of P0 xy of pq. Okay, now this is very simple. This is minus 2i sine of that argument. So I will get at the end is the sine of pi a p n divided by the sine by AP times the Fourier transform of P0 xy of PQ. Now, I would like to recall you a result that we have established previously. If I assume that the radio telescopes are square in shape, And that the other side, small d, over small d. Yeah. So I assume here that I have square aperture here. Square aperture. Yeah, with a size d by d. Yeah. Well, we have found that this is equal to, so it was d square, yeah, times the sine of pi pd over pi pd times the sine of pi qd over pi qd. Yeah. Now, if I'm interested in knowing what is the intensity distribution in the focal plane of the radio interferometer, what I find is this is the modulus square of the response function. And then I find that it is, okay. So what I do here, I divide by pi APN, then I multiply above by pi AP, and then by N, and I have to square all that, all of that, So if I do that, I find that it will be equal to N times D square, then it will be sine pi qd over pi qd square times sine pi pd over pi pd square, then times the sine pi APN over pi APN square times pi AP over sine pi AP square. Yeah. So if I didn't make a mistake, this is the final result for a radio interferometer composed of n square apertures separated by A with a size of d, small d. Yeah? So the demonstration is made in the notes, but this is okay. Yeah. Well, the final answer that we have, So what we see is that for the value of p, q, and p and q equal to 0, this is equal to 1. 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 Yeah, and that we find that the peak should have an intensity which is the square of the total surface of the collecting area. Yeah, because n d square is a total area. Yeah. Okay, that's nice. Then these terms, these two terms, just account for the Pontspeth function due to a single square aperture. Yeah? So it is a big envelope, we will see. Yeah? Now this gives us, as we will see in a moment, well, the very narrow peak in the response function, which determines the angular resolution of the radio telescope. Yeah? And these terms here gives rise to secondary peaks. Yeah. So, just to visualize this, I project it here. So you see here along the direction p, we have a big envelope, which is due to a single square aperture. Then we have the central very narrow peak. So we see a central very narrow peak, which is due, to the to the baselines, as we will see in a moment, And then we have secondary peaks, which is due to the distance between two radio telescopes. Yeah, so secondary peaks, yeah, locations, is accounted for by the distance between two consecutive radio telescopes. The width of the big envelopes is due to the size of a single radio telescope. And the width of the narrow peak is due, yeah, to the separation of the two outer radio telescopes. Yeah? So just to convince you, what I will try to do now is to show you how we may find what is the value of the angular resolution of the radio telescope, yeah? Which is determined by this term. Yeah? So I will make it on this side of the blackboard. And it is determined, yeah, by this quantity, yeah? Yeah. So we agree that it goes to zero, yeah, whenever this is equal to pi or minus pi, yeah? So whenever pi times n times p a is equal to plus or minus pi. So I divide by pi on the two sides, and I find that p is equal to plus or minus 1 over n a, which means that delta p, the width of the p, is equal to 2 over n times small a. Yeah? Because here I have plus or minus, yeah? So we find that the width, yeah? So the angular width along p is given by that. Yeah? But now you remember that p is equal to x prime divided by lambda f. Yeah? So delta p is equal to delta x prime divided by f times 1 over lambda. And it must be equal to 2 over n a. Now the angular resolution, yeah, is just defined by this quantity, yeah, which is the width in the focal plane, yeah, that I see from the center of the converging system. Yeah? So this is phi, if you want. Yeah? And I find that phi is equal to 2 lambda over n a. But n times a, yeah? So you see here, n times a, well, is a separation, yeah, between my radio telescopes, correct? 1, 2, 3. Well, more or less, almost, yeah? So this is about 2 lambda over d, yeah? Which is the distance, yeah, between the two outer radio telescopes, yeah? And I find that, indeed, yeah, if I have a big radio interferometer, yeah, well, I'm getting a very high angular resolution, yeah? So this is, in fact, yeah, where in polar coordinates, yeah, the response function of your interferometer, yeah? And if it is projected, yeah, on the plane of the sky, it looks like that, yeah? So it's very narrow along P, but still very wide along Q, because we don't have interference along the Y or Q direction, yeah? But radio astronomers, yeah, have thought about that, yeah? And here what you see is a photograph of the Mills Cross in Australia. So here they just set up, yeah, two radio interferometers perpendicular to each other. Yeah? And you make sure, yeah, that when you combine, yeah, two such array of radio telescopes, yeah, you will get, yeah, an angular resolution in P and Q, which is of that order. Yeah? Okay, so I just passed by. Now, just a few words, yeah, about the VLA. So, well, the VLA, yeah, is a configuration of 27 radio telescopes, yeah, 9 along 3 arms, which are set, yeah, at non-redundant distances. Yeah. So it means that the ratio, yeah, between any of those two distances, yeah, is not an integer number. Yeah. And one may show that it's very good for covering the UV plane. Yeah. You have a better sampling of the UV plane. Now the size of each of these radio telescopes is about 25 meters, yeah? And they may be moved along two rails with a special K kind of a locomotive, I don't know how you call that, a big diesel machine, a transporter. And in the most extended configurations, yeah, the longest distance between the two outer radio telescopes, yeah, may be of the order of 35 kilometers. Yeah. So it's huge. Yeah. So here you have, yeah, 35 kilometers, and you get a very high angular resolution. And since you may combine, yeah, well, any of those radio telescopes, yeah, in many different pairs, yeah, you get, yeah, in one shot, yeah, many fringes, yeah, in the UV plane, yeah, a very nice coverage. So it's very easy. It's 27 times 26 divided by 2. So it's 27 times 13, yeah. So it's above 400 UV data in just one shot. And so typically they integrate during one minute. After the Earth has moved, it means that the UV configuration has changed since they take another image. And afterwards they get so much UV data that they may cover the UV plane, and by your inverse Fourier transform, yeah, you may retrieve the image of the radio source, yeah, with an angular resolution given by that, yeah, which is of the order of the milli arc second, yeah. So very good. Another view of the VLA. So it's in New Mexico. And so if by chance you have the opportunity of traveling on the east coast of the USA, it's really worthwhile going there and visiting the VLA. If you have the choice between VLA or Las Vegas, yeah, where you may gamble, don't hesitate, yeah, go to the VLA. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, well then, radio astronomers in the USA, yeah, are very well organized. They said, well, why don't we try to make an even bigger area of radio telescopes, such as those at the VLA? And they did it. And this is called the Raylan Baseline Array. Yeah. So you see there are 10 radio telescopes, which are combined simultaneously. Well, using the whole USA territory, so going from Hawaii to Virgin Highlands, yeah, so about many thousand kilometers baseline. And what they do, yeah, they just transform the electric field into an intensity signal with a phase. They record it, yeah, well today on disk space, yeah, with atomic clock time, so very accurate atomic clock time. And after they just go on a very big recombiner, and they let the signals interfering, yeah. After, yeah, so not directly, and they may reconstruct a very high angular resolution images. Now, even I read that they have a new plan, yeah, to make an extended VLA, yeah. So it will be something between VLA and between VLBA, yeah. So they have a next generation VLA project. So you see here, and as I said, also here, yeah, as the Earth is turning, yeah, the baselines are changing. And then they just use one more satellite with one antenna, which is circling the Earth, to let the radio signals interfere with those of the VLA. So they did that. This is called the Halka satellite. And I will show you some images. So here is an image of a quasar, so a very compact source, yeah, probably consisting of a black hole, yeah, accreting material, and then when statisticians had predicted, yeah, perpendicular to the accreting disk are very powerful jets, yeah. And you see here, you know, even resolve, yeah, one of those jets, yeah, colliding, yeah, with the interstellar medium and creating a big blob, yeah, of radio source. Here is another example, yeah, so these are very very neat images. Here is an image, yeah, made with a VLBA, yeah, and this is typically there is a size, but this is typically 1 milli arc second, yeah. So you see extremely high details, and this is a combination of VLBA with Halka. So Halka is a satellite revolving around the Earth, yeah, with a radio telescope. Mm-hmm. And I think the Halka satellite is a Japanese one. So they just made project with the USA. Yeah. But, and here, what they see, yeah, from one day to the next, yeah, they see motions, yeah, in the radio emission, yeah, and well, already many decades ago, yeah, they could even find, yeah, motions, yeah, which, if you translate into linear speeds, yeah, is several times the speed of light, yeah, and this is known as superluminal motions, yeah, but it's absolutely possible, yeah, to explain this, yeah, without invoking superluminal velocities. And well, I would give you an example. Let's assume, yeah, that I have here, yeah, on the table mirror, yeah, and I have a flashlight here, yeah. So when I just go from that side to that side, yeah, with a given velocity, which could be the velocity of light, yeah, I know that the light beam will be reflected, yeah, on the ceiling, yeah, and it will travel, yeah, much faster. If here I have a distance of 50 centimeter, and if the ceiling is at 5 meter, it will go 10 times faster there. Yeah. So here, if here it goes at the light velocity, then it will go at 10 times light velocity. Yeah. But this is not a true velocity. Yeah. Because the light always goes at the velocity of light. Yeah. So it's an upon effect. Yeah. And it's the same explanation, yeah, for quasars, which are ejecting radio jets, yeah, at nearly the speed of light. And it just happens that the radio jet is oriented very near to the line of sight. And because of a similar effect as I explained to you now, you may account for superluminal velocities. Yeah? It's just a sort of illusion, in fact. Yeah? Okay, this is a LOFAR project. It's just a very actual project, yeah, consisting, you see, of 20,000 bipolar antenna. Well, with a size, you see, between 1.3 meters, with baseline of 1,000 kilometers, and they will cover at the end about 300,000 square meters. So I think maybe they've already covered at least 50,000 square meters. And what they do, yeah, they just play with the cursors I showed you before, yeah? Because when we're letting the signals from two radio telescopes to interfere, because by just setting the cursor in one place or another, yeah, you might just look at different kinds of objects, well, at different directions of objects, yeah? Now, such a project, yeah, has been even more extended. It's called the Square Kilometer Array, and it is a project which has been approved, and it will be partly located in Australia, partly in Africa. The baseline here will be about 3,000 kilometers, yeah, but they will have a collecting area of 1 million square meters. Yeah. And this is very actual, yeah, and there is a lot of money at the European Commission, yeah, to participate to that project. Yeah. And therefore, I'm just presenting all those projects because, well, there will be a very high demand on engineers, physicists, yeah, to help, well, for setting such a big project and then making use of the data. Well, this is a view of another ideographs. This is just, you see, an array of radio telescopes, as I showed you here, but just observe the sun, yeah, in circularly polarized light. Yeah. And so it's just following the sun constantly, even when there are clouds, yeah, because you get the signal through the clouds. And they know when there will be a storm on Earth, yeah, and, in order to take precautions for the satellites, orbiting satellites, so that they are not hit, yeah, or they may just be put on safe mode. Yeah. No, but sufficient for the sun, yeah? Yeah. Now here, we're just a nice view, yeah, of the location of the VLT and of ALBA. I will talk a little bit about it, yeah. This is the Andes, yeah, in Chile. Here is the Pacific. Here is the south, north. And this is a view taken from a space shuttle, and you see here the Hubble Space Telescope, yeah. So it's a very nice view. So this is a very high plateau, yeah, in south, well, in north of Chile, at an altitude of 5,000 meters, yeah, and it was identified to construct ALMA. So this was at the time of the design, what it should look like. And this is still another view of the designs. And here are real images, taken not a long time ago, of some of the 60 antenna which would compose the ALMA interferometer, working in the millimeter and submillimeter wavelength range. And there also they will need a lot of people, engineers and astronomers. So here you see some of those antenna were constructed by Japanese, by US Americans, also by Europeans. And you see they all have a different style. So you could see that, you could say that this is a Japanese. You agree or not? Well, to me, it's obvious. Well, this is another view of the antenna as they are today. So it's very impressive. And where the radio telescopes are connected by with optical fibers. And the signal goes through the optical fibers. So it's very easy to later on correlate those signals. But you need very, very big computers. This is a view on the tunnel transporters of the antenna because they may change the configuration from one day to the next. Yes, correct. Good, Leo. Another view from an airplane, how they are dispersed just to cover the UV plane in an efficient way. Oh, this one was when there was some snow. It's very nice, very nice view. Well, we even went there on the top here. It's 5,500 meters, very high. Then you are short and short of oxygen. Different view, where one antenna being transported. And those people working there just have bottles of oxygen with themselves, to just in case of failure, it's necessary. Well, this is still an active volcano, very nice. Another view during the night time. You see where is the South Pole? So here we are at a declination of about minus 22 degrees, something like that. So the South Pole is minus 90 degrees, therefore it's very low, Here you may see the Milky Way. What's that? Moon? Yes, the moon. Of course, But still you see the Milky Way, even when the moon is there, It's very nice.
In the middle of the Milky Way,
So you guess what are these? Magellanic clouds, very nice, And this is the view, of a disk information around the star, which will give rise certainly to the formation of planets, And it was made with ALMA. So this is after reconstruction, of all the visibilities, taken for all values of the UV plane, well covered, an image. Without a model, So here you don't need a model. So what you will do during the laboratories is, of course, something different. You will take some visibilities with different baselines, and then you will assume, well, we assume that it is a uniform disk of source of light, Or we may also assume that it's a binary star, And then already for the binary, what is interesting is that the mask, which is there, you may turn it around, And if you see differences, when you turn it around, it means that, well, it's very likely a binary and not a uniform disk, Because a uniform disk will not change, But the binary would change in size, Okay, so that's all for my part, So now we make a break, And if there is